Creative Guitar Studio. I had a question that was sent to me from off of my YouTube channel by fellow YouTuber Julian1345. And he wrote in saying, I have a question that got me struggling for days. I didn't find a lot of information about flat picking online. Is there a good or correct way to pick when playing single notes? Because my pinky and my middle finger are always resting on the guitar. Is this a bad habit? Because I've seen a lot of players have their hand resting on the bridge, or at least near the bridge. So to answer this question, I'm going to do this video in two parts. The first part is going to be dedicated to the what I feel anyway, about 6 points that I feel is a good short criteria list of what you should have going on to develop really decent right hand picking with flat pick. And then the second part of the video, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at more of an idea very tailored to the question that Julian wrote in. And it's basically going to be around, you know, how you can sort of float your hand over the strings, give yourself a sense of security of where exactly the tip of that pick is when you're doing your flat pick playing. So let's get going right to part one, and we're going to go through these 6 points, my short criteria list, what I feel is really important for your picking hand. So let's get to that right now. So let's run through this short list of 6 things that I think are really important to build a really solid awareness of what's going on with your picking hand, and to hopefully improve that to a decent level. Now, I gotta make a quick disclaimer here before we get too involved in this. I'm teaching you my methods that I've used around the studio here for years to help people pick and play better with their, you know, with their picking hand technique. There's other ways, and you'll certainly see other guitar players doing different things out there, but I've found that these ways that I've been teaching now for quite a long time, they're very effective, and they have helped lots of folks really develop this technique to a really solid level. So let's start off with point number one, which is basically the way of holding the guitar pick. I think it's really effective to hold the guitar pick between your thumb and your index finger. Essentially, just place the pick on the side of your index finger and have your thumb come up over top. So it's kind of like the edge, the side of the edge there where the edge of the fingernail is. That just becomes kind of like a little shelf. You put your thumb over top. And I think the other fingers are best off just curled into the palm of your hand. Okay, so that's the holding of the pick. Point number one. Number two, what I think is really important is to find the best picking area on whatever guitar it is that you own. For my Stratocaster here, the best picking area I find is between my neck position pickup and my middle position pickup. So I find this region right in here is just really effective. So you have to find that comfort zone for your particular guitar. And I'm saying especially about, you know, people's particular guitars, because you could have different kinds of pickup, you know, configurations, and you could find yourself kind of clipping out on the top of a pickup if you have the pull pieces set quite high to the strings. So, you know, there's some elements there that you want to, you know, either change perhaps about your guitar's setup, or just, you know, find a way around it physically to get that sort of optimum potential position where you can get the best picking possible for yourself. Okay, so that's number two. Now, number three, I think in for me personally and for a lot of people that I work with, I think the easiest muscle group to go from to develop your picking is from the wrist. You know, it's a rather large muscle, and it's got a lot of control, so you can have precise movement from it. But if you localize your muscle group from where you're picking from, what I find that's really effective about that is you don't have a lot of other muscle groups involved which could potentially open the door for mistakes. And what I mean by that is, let's say you're picking with, you know, an elbow movement, and there's some rotation of the forearm. Let's say there's even movement of the wrist, or even, you know, add on top of that some movement of the fingertips as well. It's got lots of muscle groups. There's lots of room for error to creep in with all those muscle groups going on. Now, what if we just eliminated a lot of those muscle groups out of the picture, and we just went only from the wrist, and the wrist was the key component to the picking? All of a sudden now you've limited everything. You've kind of developed one economical area, a muscle group area where you're picking from. It's gonna have some good power behind it, and it's also gonna have a good deal of accuracy that, you know, if you hold your pick fairly, you know, in position, that wrist is gonna, you know, really be a good, you know, powerful and accurate way of getting some fast picking developed. Okay, so that's point number three. Number four, I really want to stress this part. It's really, really important to keep tension and anxiety when you play down. So that means, you know, if you're playing gigs, be very well rehearsed. The more experience you have with gigs, of course, too, the more relaxed you get on stage. But tension itself, in and of itself, is really one of the primary causes of poor performance. And especially when it comes time, let's say, you know, you're comfortable with your songs in your band, but then it comes time for you to play that solo. So all of a sudden you get some anxiety, you know, the adrenaline starts flowing, you're on stage, you know, there's a whole whack of people watching you, and you kind of clip out on notes and it gets sloppy. It's that idea of that tension building up. So you've got to somehow keep reminding yourself to relax and just stay on top of your game and try not to have any, you know, bad thoughts pop into your head. Because you may have experienced already where you have like a bad, you know, thought come in like, gosh, I hope I don't blow this line. And then what happens? You blow the line, you know. So that's a part of, you know, talking to yourself, trying to get very relaxed with yourself, keep the tension down and try to stay fairly positive about how you're going to get that solo, you know, off and... you know, just sort of trust in your own abilities that things will go the best that they possibly can. If you make a mistake, you know, just try to get out of it as quickly as possible so nobody notices and so forth. So anyway, tension. It's a really tough one there, but, you know, point number four is huge if you can keep that level of tension down to a bare minimum. Okay, number five. Let's talk about the angle of the pick that you would have into the string set. This is a kind of a crucial one for speed. Now, a lot of people, when they're picking, their pick is quite flat against the string. Now, that particular type of motion offers a lot of resistance against the string and against the guitar pick, especially if you're using a slightly heavier gauge pick. So what you want to do instead is have your pick angle slightly so that the edge of the guitar pick actually just slips over the string and does the picking instead of the flat portion of the pick. And the way you can think of this or achieve this, you know, inside your own physical attack into the string set, their physical makeup, you know, when you're getting into the guitar to play, is think of your ignition in your automobile. And if you're going to turn the key in the lock in the ignition, you're going to turn it slightly like that. And that's kind of like the turn that you need, your thumbnail going into the, you know, pointing toward the floor a little bit. That's the same kind of an angle that your hand and your wrist and your arm would take to develop that correct angle for the picking. All right, so that's point number five, the angle of the pick, having it at a slight angle so it slips over the string easier, really helps the speed in the long run too. Now, number six, this is a very important one because what it has to do with is economy of motion. Now, too much unwanted motion in a pick swing can really cause you some problems. And what I mean by this is, let's say you picked a note and your pick went away from the guitar string about a good inch. Well, if you think about it, it's got to come back through an inch of dead airspace before you're gonna actually connect with the string again. So that's a lot of wasted energy. Now, what would be better, an inch or maybe like 3 millimeters, like a tiny movement, like about an eighth of an inch or so instead of a full inch? That's a big difference all of a sudden. Your pick will be right there on the next upstrum. And you know, I'm a pretty big proponent of the idea of learning alternate picking as soon as possible. You know, even if you're quite a new player, you can get alternate picking into your technique as fast as possible. It's really helpful. But what this whole idea that we just talked about here in point number six has to do with mostly is economy of motion, minimal pick swing. So you have barely anything of a movement there that will really help you develop speed. Now we're going to come back in just a moment with part two of this video where we're going to talk about how to develop sort of a sense of security of exactly where the tip of your pick is and how to help you kind of get that idea of floating your hand over the strings to give you that sort of idea of where your tip of your guitar pick is without actually anchoring in any way down onto the bridge or onto the face of the guitar. So I'm going to come back in just a minute with part two of this video covering that topic. So in the second part of this video, what I want to talk about is how you can develop a very high sense of awareness of exactly where the tip of your pick is without having to go and necessarily anchor your hand down in any one specific location and all of a sudden regenerating, you know, your picking motions from one set anchor point, which I think really limits the use of your muscle groups. So what we're going to do is we're going to think of our strings in two sets. We're going to have a set of three, the bass strings. We'll have a set of upper three treble strings. If you're playing on the bass strings, what you do is you lightly brush the top of your baby finger's first small knuckle right behind the fingernail. Just brush that knuckle lightly on those high strings that aren't in use. That's going to give you a very good sense of security of exactly where the tip of that guitar pick is on those low bass strings. Now, when you happen to be playing on the upper three strings, what you do is you lightly brush the heel on the palm of the hand right there on those lower strings that aren't in use. And then you get a very high sense of awareness of exactly where your pick is on those upper three strings when you're playing on them. And you can tell now with this method, there's no anchoring from one central point going on in any way. And the brushing effect also adds a good sense of muting to the string sets, which is really, really valuable if you're dealing with a lot of distortion that you have to, you know, couple your hands across the neck and create a lot of muted sound so that you don't get a lot of unwanted string noise with all that extra sustain that the distortion and overdrive produces. So anyway, that's pretty much in a nutshell what this is all about. I mean, it's sort of an idea of getting a high sense of awareness of exactly where the tip of that guitar pick is at your guitar strings. So anyway, that draws us to the end of this video on flat pick technique and picking technique. Hope you've enjoyed it and hope you've got some good things that you walk away from this video with, and hopefully it helps your playing quite a bit. So until next time, keep jamming and practicing on all this stuff, and until then, we'll see you on the next video. Take care now. We'll see you next time.